In our series on the Old Testament prophet Jeremiah, today we come to Jeremiah's famous sermon in the temple in chapter 7. Preaching it almost cost him his life. Chapter 26 apparently describes the same incident. There we read that when Jeremiah preached this sermon around the year 609 or 608 BC during the reign of King Jehoiakim, the officials, the priests, the prophets, and all the people immediately wanted to kill him. Chapter 7 helps us understand why. I remember walking out of a church one Sunday at the end of a service years ago, and a woman from the congregation turned to me and said, "Isn't that nice? We're all clean for the week now." She spoke as if going to church gave us a free pass for the week ahead. We've been to church and now we're good for the week, regardless of what we do. But that's not how biblical religion works in the Old Testament or the New Testament. An hour at church on Sunday morning does not wash away a week of godless living. To separate external religion from living faithfulness and trust in the externals is deluded and dangerous. Jeremiah's sermon exposes that delusion and danger, confronting the people with three related falsehoods: false worship, false words, and false security. First, false worship. "This is the word that came to Jeremiah from the Lord. Stand at the gate of the Lord's house, and there proclaim this message. Hear the word of the Lord, all you people of Judah who come through these gates to worship the Lord. This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Reform your ways and your actions, and I will let you live in this place. If you really change your ways and your actions and deal with each other justly, if you do not oppress the foreigner, the fatherless, or the widow, and do not shed innocent blood in this place, and if you do not follow other gods to your own harm, then I will let you live in this place, in the land I gave to your ancestors forever and ever." The Old Testament prophets consistently address two sins: injustice and idolatry, and they are both part of the false worship Jeremiah confronts. Did you notice that God's charge against the people recalls many of the Ten Commandments? Worship involves showing God's worth and worthiness in every part of life. We engage in false worship when our ethical behavior and religious practice are inconsistent with our profession of faith. This week, Chris and Grace, our mission partners in Timor-Leste, wrote about the upcoming Spirits of the Dead Day. The spirits of the deceased members of the family are an integral part of the lived experience of many Timorese life. Spirits of the Dead Day is set apart to affirm the family's dedication to the spirits of the dead. Our Timorese friends let us know that the observance of the Catholic tradition of remembrance and prayer for the deceased ones, in particular in order to transition those in purgatory to heaven, is often involved. However, what is more significant in the core of Timorese culture and identity is what happens in each household that functions to ensure blessings from the deceased ones and avoid any possibility of receiving curses. Families display photos of the deceased ones in the house with special food and other items prepared for them. A designated member of the family prays to invite the spirits into their presence. Family members will leave the room for the deceased ones to accept the offerings. Then the family members will return and eat the sacrificial food prepared for the deceased ones, with a special prayer asking the spirits to bless the family. What is most grieving is that many professing Christians who are part of our church also take part in this false worship. What is Even more grieving is that many Christian leaders, especially in the districts, willingly take part in it. Does your culture of origin have a custom like that? You might not make offerings to your ancestors next week, but perhaps during a typical week, you engage in ruthless practices at work or seek some unfair advantage in life, or show no concern for those whose lives are a desperate struggle, or demonstrate by the way you spend your time that your career or bank balance or sex life or social media profile or sharing the latest piece of juicy gossip matters more to you than honouring the God you claim to worship. False. What does God say when his people profess to worship him but practice injustice and idolatry? This is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Go ahead, add your burnt offerings to your other sacrifices and eat the meat yourselves. For when I brought your ancestors out of Egypt and spoke to them, I did not just give them commands about burnt offerings and sacrifices, but I gave them this command: obey me, and I will be your God, and you will be my people. Walk in obedience to all I command you, that it may go well with you. True religion consists in faithful obedience, not just ritual observance. Without ethical and spiritual obedience, our religious practice does not honour God, it insults him. Not only that, but twice God laments in Jeremiah 7 that the people are harming themselves by worshipping false gods. You see, idols demand sacrifices too. Jeremiah 7 paints a pervasive picture of false worship involving the whole family. The children gather wood, the fathers light the fire, and the women knead the dough and make cakes to offer to the Queen of Heaven. They pour out drink offerings to other gods to arouse my anger. Moving on from this family picture, just a few verses later, we read that the sacrifices demanded by the false gods the people were serving included the unthinkable horror of child sacrifice. They have built the high places of Topheth in the valley of Ben Hinnom to burn their sons and daughters in the fire, something I did not command, nor did it enter my mind. It might not be the horror of child sacrifice, though our world has many ways of sacrificing children, but all idols demand sacrifices, and in serving them we harm ourselves and those around us. Alongside God-insulting, self-harming false worship, Jeremiah confronts false words. In chapter 7, God says of the whole nation, "Truth has perished. It has vanished from their lips." There is a more specific kind of false words that Jeremiah warns us about. Do not trust in deceptive words and say, "This is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord." But look, you are trusting in deceptive words that are worthless. In the face of Jeremiah's message of judgment, the people trust that all is well because they have the temple, God's special dwelling place among them. This problem lies not just with the people in general, but with their leaders in particular. In chapters 6 and 8, we read this identical description of the false words being pronounced by the people's religious leaders. From the least to the greatest, all are greedy for gain. Prophets and priests alike all practice deceit. They dress the wound of my people as though it were not serious. Peace, peace, they say, when there is no peace. One preacher I heard imagines the people of Judah gathering at the temple one Sabbath, dressed in their Sabbath best, waiting to hear what they were used to. Nice preachers telling nice people that their nice God approves of their nice lives, so the people can go away saying, "Wasn't that nice?" And the preachers can receive a nice salary. What a nice picture. And what a false one. Be careful of listening to leaders who tell you what you want to hear. The New Testament gives this sober warning. For the time will come when people will not put up with sound doctrine. Instead, to suit their own desires, they will gather round them a great number of teachers to say what their itching ears want to hear. The combination of false worship and false words makes for a deadly cocktail of false security. Through Jeremiah, God calls out the people's false confidence. Will you steal and murder, commit adultery and perjury, burn incense to Baal and follow other gods you have not known, and then come and stand before me in this house which bears my name and say, we are safe. Safe to do all these detestable things? Has this house which bears my name become a den of robbers to you? But I have been watching, declares the Lord. Some friends of ours were serving in student ministry overseas some years ago. While they were in Australia for home assignment one time, they allowed some of the students they were working with to live in their house rent-free, provided that the students took care of the house and paid the running costs. The students expressed enthusiasm and gratitude for this opportunity. 6 months later, our friends returned to find that all the services had been disconnected because the students had not paid the bills. The students had also driven our friend's vehicle, damaged it in an accident, and left it unrepaired and undrivable. Do you think those students were welcome in that home after that? According to Jeremiah 7, such is the false security of the people that not only do they live in a way that is inconsistent with their temple worship, but they have brought their idolatry into the temple itself. The people of Judah have done evil in my eyes, declares the Lord. They have set up their detestable idols in the house that bears my name, and have defiled it. Even so, they repeat their mantra, "This is the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord, the temple of the Lord." God is not bound to the temple, however, and no religious mantra or sacred place or religious institution will protect a people whose lives and worship are an insult to the living God. Go now to the place in Shiloh where I first made a dwelling for my name, and see what I did to it because of the wickedness of my people Israel. While you were doing all these things, declares the Lord, I spoke to you again and again, but you did not listen. I called you, but you did not answer. Therefore, what I did to Shiloh, I will now do to the house that bears my name, the temple you trust in, the place I gave to you and your ancestors. I will thrust you from my presence, just as I did all your fellow Israelites, the people of Ephraim. The shrine at Shiloh had been the central sanctuary for all Israel long before Jerusalem. Now, because of God's judgment on his people's wickedness, it was no more. If Shiloh could fall, why not Jerusalem and its temple? As the people's stubborn refusal to listen continues, it seems increasingly that their fate is sealed. God speaks these chilling words to Jeremiah in verse 16. So do not pray for this people, nor offer any plea or petition for them. Do not plead with me, for I will not listen to you. The people would not listen to God's word through Jeremiah, so now God will not listen to Jeremiah's words on behalf of the people. A Christian heritage is a great blessing, but there is a grave danger of false security when we come from a country or culture or community or family that regards itself as Christian by default. If our religion is cultural Christianity without commitment, if we have family faith but not personal faith, if our worship involves church going without faithful living, then we are Christians in name only, and there is no security in that. Friends, remember, God has many children, but no grandchildren. Each one of us must choose to trust and follow Jesus. The people rejected God's word in the words of Jeremiah. Over the years, they rejected God's word through many prophets. 6 centuries later, Jesus told a parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard. He put a wall around it, dug a wine press, and built a watchtower. Then he rented the vineyard to tenants. When he sent his servants to collect the rent at harvest time, the tenants beat one, killed another, and stoned a third. The landowner sent more servants who suffered similarly. Finally, he sent his own son, saying, "They will respect my son." But the tenants said to themselves, "He is the heir. Let's kill him and the inheritance will be ours." So they killed him. Jesus asks, "What then will the owner of the vineyard do?" He will come and kill those tenants and give the vineyard to others. God is the landowner. Old Testament Israel are the tenants, the prophets are the servants, and Jesus is the son who was killed. The return of the landowner means judgment for those who have treated him, his servants, and his son with contempt. But that is not all. Jesus continues in the next verse, quoting from Psalm 118. "Haven't you read this passage of Scripture? The stone the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes." Jesus was rejected and killed, but God raised him to life and made him the cornerstone or capstone of a new structure, a new temple, into which others will be welcomed as God's people. And that is marvelous news. To come to Jesus in true worship, to trust and follow him, is to come to the temple where true security is found.